So we'll begin today's session. These are some of the things that I'm going to talk to you about. That is, we'll try to understand first what is the learning process, what is learning? I'm a psychologist, as Professor Kripal said. So learning is it's a classic concept in psychology. So I'll briefly talk about what is learning and what do we mean by the learning process. What are learning styles of students? What can be our teaching styles and what is our role as teachers? How can we cater to those styles? And how to avoid our own personal biases when we are teaching students? We should not use predominantly a singular style, because there are going to be a number of styles which are being practiced by students. So we'll talk of implications for teaching. So this is the overview that we'll be looking at. Let's begin with what is learning all about. A psychology text would define learning very simply as a process of change due to practice or experience. So whenever, and this change should be relatively permanent. Unless it's relatively permanent, it's not change. So when we use the word learning, that would mean that some change has occurred in the person due to some kind of experience with that object, with that issue, with that concept, and that change becomes relatively permanent. When I'm using the word relatively permanent, I would also then imply that learning is linked very closely to memory. You cannot separate the two. However, when I use the word memory, a layman would feel, or a teacher would feel, who's not a psychologist, that memory would be rote memory, trying to mug up something by rehearsing a particular concept over and over again, and then trying to store it in your storehouse. So memory works like a computer. Learning is a part of memory in the sense that, just like in memory, there are two steps involved over here. That is, the first is reception of the input. Now this reception in learning can be external, it can be internal. When I say external, that means what you are seeing here, what you are hearing, that I am saying is external input. But what is internal input? Many of you will be thinking in your minds simultaneously about what I am saying and how you are relating it to what happens inside a classroom and how students memorize and learn. So you are trying to even think internally about the learning process. So that is also reception internally. Why are you doing that? So that you are able to retain it somewhere. So you are trying to elaborate on the concepts mentally of what's going on inside the classroom. So when I use the word reception, it's both external and internal. Very often there may be no external inputs, there can just be internal inputs. Like you just sit down and think about something. In that process also you are learning something, because you are using intuition, hunch, in understanding a particular concept. So you can have an internal kind of input also. There is some kind of processing occurring. When I am using the word processing, it would primarily mean, putting it very explicitly, processing for a student may mean repeating what is being taught. So you have seen little children who repeat. Then they may to sing songs inside a class or nursery rhymes inside a class over and over again. Or they are made to say the tables over and over again. So the processing is very obvious. That if you repeat something over and over again, you tend to retain it. As we grow older, we may not do it so explicitly, but we may do it internally. We are processing that information. So any information which is processed in some manner or the other, it could be through paraphrasing, it could be through intuitive thinking, you are processing that information. And once that information is processed, it's retained in your storehouse, that's memory, and whenever necessary, you should be able to retrieve it or bring it out. So just as the computer works, our memory also works in the same way, that there is an input, there is a processing, there is a storehouse, and when necessary, you will retrieve it. Now the question arises, why is it that we're not able to retrieve it on time? I am not using the word forgetting. Forgetting is different from retrieval. You are sometimes not, you know, you may have kept a pen somewhere. And you know that you have kept it somewhere, but you are not able to get it. Why don't you get it? It's because you have stored it in memory somewhere, but you have stored it in the wrong file. If you're storing in a wrong file, you have to search that file. That searching process takes a long time. So when you're having a bath, suddenly you remember, aha, I kept it there. Now I remember. So you pull it out from the memory. It's there in the memory, but it's stored incorrectly. So when you are storing information, you have to store it in the right file. So just as, say for example, in a library, there are classification systems. In a computer, there are files and folders and subdirectories and directories and so on and so forth. The whole concept of computerization is based on the concept of memory. And learning and memory are very, very closely linked to one another. So I thought I'll talk a little bit over here about memory, because learning involves these two steps of the memory process. When I use the word style, learning style, it would mean that it is some consistent mechanism of responding or learning. We also use words like personality style. I'm using your learning style. Anything which is consistent becomes a style. And in the context of learning, the way in which we take the input and the way in which we process it predominantly becomes our style. So the word learning style has told this consistent way of responding to and using stimuli in the context of learning. So say for example, somebody may say, why is it that teachers lecture so much? Why don't they show us films? What does it mean? The person has a predominantly visual style of learning, is able to retain information if you show the person what's being taught rather than talk about it. So the usage of multiple methods of teaching instead of using just one style. Little children remember what they saw on the television but don't remember what's taught inside the classroom. Why? That's because they're using visual learning more than auditory learning. And for little children, visual styles are more predominant. As you grow older, you learn to use both those styles well. But still, a particular style may predominate. We'll come back to various kinds of styles. So it classifies the students according to where they fit on a scale, measuring their way of receiving and processing information. I gave you a scale or an inventory to measure your style. Similarly, there are hundreds of learning style inventories, scales, questionnaire to map a student's learning style, and that's why it's written over here that you can classify a person's style by using these inventories. So in psychology, when we're using a particular term, they're very, if I were to just say learning style, it would appear to be very abstract. How do I tap style? Unlike in engineering, where you can measure things. In psychology also we measure things by questionnaires and scales, and similarly we can tap or measure learning styles through various scales of measurement, and that's what the second point indicates, that I can measure or map those styles. Now you'll ask me, but in a classroom I can't do it. How do I find out what are the styles of my students? There may be no need to do it, however, but what this particular session is primarily giving you an exposure to what could be the various styles that a student uses. If you're aware of it, you will adapt your teaching styles accordingly. So I'm 100% sure that you will not go to your class and say, now come on, let's measure your learning style. And I want to cater to your learning style. That's not going to happen. But the very fact that you're having a session on learning style implies that it will give you an exposure to what could be the styles that the students inside the classroom use. And that may help you in developing the way in which you teach inside the classroom. So if there is a learning style, there should be a teaching style also, a synonymous teaching style. So we will look at what could be the various teaching styles that we can use to cater to the learning styles of students. So teaching style model classifies methods of instructions on the basis of how well they address the learning style of the student. However, it would be erroneous to say that every learning style would have a corresponding teaching style. Usually teaching styles, we try to mix many styles together when we are teaching, that is a better style, and we try to generate or try to cater to as many students as possible. There is some literature which says that in engineering education particularly, the predominant learning style is concrete experimentation. And for higher order courses, and there are some examples of chemical engineering courses which they say, you may need the abstract style more. So there may be certain types of courses where concrete styles are more important, certain courses where abstract thinking is more important. So we will look at those things as well. So what is our role as teachers? One thing we have to recognize, no two people are identical. So obviously all students are different in a classroom. Even identical twins are not identical. They may look alike. But there is sufficient literature in psychologists which say that their personalities may not be identical. The environment may have some role to play. So you cannot expect that all students in the class would have the same kind of learning style. We have to recognize the fact that there are individual differences, and you are using one mechanism to teach. So everybody is not going to absorb everything that's been taught inside the classroom equitably. There are going to be differences. And if they get bored, in quotes I'm using the word bored, that is, you are not able to fulfill some of their learning styles or meet up to their learning styles, they may get bored again, in quotes. If they get bored, they may perform badly. Some of them may even give up. You've heard of cases where students after 1 year of engineering education say, I can't do it, it's not my cup of tea. It's because there has been a kind of a mismatch between many things. It's their needs and the goals have not matched with engineering education, or maybe the style of the teacher doesn't match with the way in which they are able to take in information. Because there may be other students who are doing very well in that course, but there may be some who are not doing too well in that course. And then want to give up engineering education midway. So you have to be a little careful of some of the outcomes of this mismatch of learning and teaching styles. Some students may perform badly, 1 year is, or students may do well in one course but not on the other. Because one course requires concrete learning and the other one requires abstract learning, and the student style may be predominantly concrete. And so is not able to do well in the abstract learning course. So you cannot come to a conclusion that the student is a bad student. The student has a particular style of learning, and there could be that reason that is influencing the learning process. So there can be some negative outcomes of the way in which we teach inside a classroom. So addressing these learning styles with a teaching plan becomes very, very important, and that's why it's essential for us to understand this learning process. Of course, making students aware of various learning styles and help them choose suitable ones. I don't know whether we'll be able to do this because there are hundreds of students inside a classroom, and whether we'll be able to identify everybody's learning styles and whether we'll be able to help them. But if we are able to make them aware, we can see the last point is very important, that is self-directed learning. Help students understand the learning styles and develop ways of coping with the ways in which the classroom teacher is teaching inside the classroom. So they can direct that energy in such a way that they learn to pick up cues which suit their needs and their goals. So self-directed learning becomes very, very important in the role of teachers. The inventory that I gave you is based on this model of Cole and Fry, This was the earliest model given on learning styles, which talks about four kinds of learning styles. One is concrete experience, that's CE. The second is observation and reflection. The third is abstract concepts. And the fourth is testing in new situations. If you look that it is circular and the arrows point in the direction which shows that learning is a continuous process. It never stops. We are learning because if human beings stop learning, this world would come to a standstill. It's not happening. So that means that learning is a continuous process. So this model is based on this first assumption that learning is continuous. It's based on the second assumption that learning is based on one's needs and goals. Everybody has different needs and everybody has different goals. And that's why somebody takes up engineering, somebody takes up commerce, and somebody takes up science, and somebody wants to pursue only mathematics and so on and so forth. So everybody chooses according to their goals and their needs, what they want to learn. The third thing it is based on is that because it's based on needs and wants, and because it's a continuous process, learning can also vary, or the style of learning can also vary from one situation to another. That is, our needs and wants may change with time. If it's continuous, our needs and wants should change with time. That's why we keep on learning. So because our goals may change with time, our learning style may also change. It doesn't imply that once a learning style has been formed, it remains our learning style forever. That doesn't really happen. Based on this, you will see that there are four kinds of abilities that one develops. Now, this is based on Cole's model. One is concrete experience abilities. What does concrete experience abilities mean? That once you have experienced something, you have an experience with something, you want to see what its outcome would be. So you try to understand the outcome based on a particular type of cause. After having, you see that all the four are interlinked. After having done that, you want to reflect upon whether the same outcome will be experienced if the same situation recurs again. If the same situation recurs again, whether there is going to be the same outcome, reflective observation. You have made a particular observation. Then you reflect on whether the same cause-effect relationship is going to hold true when the same situation occurs again. After having done that, you start wondering whether you can extend that, or in scientific language, generalize this cause-effect relationship to other situations. So abstract conceptualization. Now you have not had any experience with it. What are you doing? You are developing principles in the third step. That's how principles develop. Abstract conceptualization. You test those principles by experimenting it. Generalization has occurred. You have tested what began in the first step to the in the last one. In a sense, these four abilities are interlinked with one another. I will describe to you an experiment on learning which involves these steps. Have you all heard about a physiologist by the name Pavlov? Some of you may have heard of Pavlov. He was a Nobel laureate in the 1900s. He was a physiologist, not a psychologist, but the entire research on learning began with his experiments. He was studying, that was concrete experience, he was studying really the the digestive system of dogs in a laboratory. And he noticed, now this is concrete experience, he noticed that dogs start salivating even before the food is given to them. Obviously, salivation should occur when food is there, but dogs started salivating without the food being there. So that was some experience that he had. So he started wondering, reflective observation, why this happens. He found that there could be, one of the reasons could be that the dogs have started recognizing the attendant who brings the food. And the moment he sees the attendant, starts salivating. So abstract conceptualization. There is something in our brain, some association has occurred between a natural stimulus that is food and an unnatural stimulus that is the attendant. So he gave us the concept of conditioned stimulus and unconditioned stimulus, where the conditioned stimulus is eliciting an unconditioned response, which is now that is salivation. Like unconditioned response, I mean it's a natural response. And then he did active experimentation in the on the dogs, where he actually rang a bell before food was given. And he saw the dog started salivating at the sound of the bell. It's as simple as you notice your child. I have noticed it. When the child is little and you have to feed the child, obviously you crush the food into small pieces or you put it in a mixer so the child is able to swallow it. The child starts jumping when it hears the sound of the mixer, hoping that the food is forthcoming. It's as simple as that. So learning has occurred, and the association is actually formed with the mixer and not with the food. The food obviously is coming. So the excitement begins with the sound. And that's what this actually, this whole process, these four steps that he gave is based on this, that we have some experience in our everyday life or in observations. Sometimes we even experiment in that experimentation, because actually Pavlov was doing some experiments on the digestive system and not on learning. And then he saw that he developed a whole theory of classical conditioning on learning. So that's how learning actually occurs, and Korb gave these four steps of learning. Based on these styles of Kolb, based on these concepts of Kolb, four styles have been generated, and I've written these: converger, diverger, assimilator, and accommodator. The converger if you see, it's a mix of abstract conceptualization and active experimentation. What does the converger do, or how does he behave? What is the kind of learning style? Such individuals have a strong practical application of ideas. The convergers are very good at practical applications. So don't teach them too much theory. They may not be able to, or they are not interested. They may get bored if you teach convergers too much of theories. If you teach them how to apply these theories, they will be able to assimilate the theory better. So maybe you can begin with the application and then go to the theory. That's what it means. The word converge means that they're able to converge on one particular outcome or solution to a problem. The diverger, on the other hand, is based on a concept given in intelligence, convergent and divergent, convergent and divergent thinking, or convergent and divergent intelligence. The diverger is who is a mix of concrete experience and reflective observation, is actually very good in imaginative abilities. So such people can, so if you give them a problem in a classroom, they will come up with many alternatives to solve that problem. They may eventually never solve it, but they will give you many alternatives. you can solve it in this way, this way, this way. The converger will solve it in one best way that he thinks, because he's practical oriented. The third kind, the assimilator, was a mix of abstract conceptualization and reflective observation. Is the one who can develop good mathematical models, because abstract conceptualization is very strong. Reflective observation is very strong. He is intuitive. So can develop models. Is good at mathematical models. The accommodator, who is a mix of concrete experience and active experimentation, you will see, is basically a person who solves problems intuitively. His greatest strength also lies in, after having thought intuitively, would also do it practically, experimentation. Would experiment. So we'll have an idea and we'll do the experiment. That's the accommodator. So all this is based on Kolb styles. Learning can begin at any point. Though you see that they say that concrete experience is the first step, it may not necessarily be the first step. Concrete experience may not necessarily be the first step. You can begin either with observation or reflection. So you must just, you know, you've heard of armchair thinking. They say philosophers do armchair thinking, that is, they sit down and think, why is the world like this? Or why do people lie? Or why do people not lie? Or what is justice? They sit down and think, observation, and then they think about it after having observed it in the external world. They don't do any experimentation. And then they come up with all kinds of logical arguments of why people are just or why they are unjust. So you can begin learning and any of these four. That's what Kolb is saying. It's not at all essential that you have to begin with concrete experience. There is a probability that one of them is predominant in your learning process. So this is what we are looking at. Now we'll come to another kind of model which is different from Kolb's model. And that is the VAC model. VAC is visual learners, auditory learners, and kinesthetic learners. Odor, touch, those may not be important for classroom purposes, we are not talking about it. Even kinesthetic is not all that important, but to some extent there is. However, there is some experimentation even on odors, smell. They say that with certain types of smell, people learn better. However, that is still not established, so we will not talk about it. Mostly, literature talks about the VAC model, visual, auditory, and kinesthetic. Visual learners are the ones who learn better by seeing. Obviously, the term indicates that they learn better when you show them something. You demonstrate something to them. You show them graphs. You show them illustrations. In a sense, even words are visual. You see words. So there's a difference between visual linguistic and visual spatial. When I say visual linguistic, they are the ones who will learn when they see and read the words. This is visual linguistic. You're seeing here what's being written. I could just switch this off and just talk. The effect will be different. It would be entirely auditory. But at the moment, it's visual linguistic. When I showed you Kolb's model, which was the drawing, the diagram, it is visual spatial. There aren't words. There can be a flow chart, there can be a diagram, there can be a bar chart, there can be a pie diagram, visual spaceship. So when you're writing a thesis or when you're writing a report, you tend to produce your data both visually, that is you make graphs, and you describe it also in written form. If you are predominantly visual, you would learn better if something is shown to you. The teacher demonstrated inside the classroom, shows you a film. Why do we use films for teaching? It's because visual, it caters to visual learners. Auditory learners, actually visual learners may get bored if the lecture is only auditory. So you need to use audiovisual aids in teaching. That's why they use audiovisual. So auditory learners are the ones who learn better on hearing. The hearing ability is well developed. They are the ones who, even students who are auditory learners, are the ones who would read aloud. Many of you are doing it, that when you want to retain something, you read aloud. You read to yourself. They are the auditory learners. Because they feel that they can retain better if they listen to what they are saying. They are the ones who will learn better if they are allowed to teach someone else. You know, the best way of learning is teaching. There are many things which you teach, or many courses which you teach in your colleges which you may never have studied. At least I have done that. And I find that teaching, auditory, teaching is the best mechanism. Even visual in a sense, because I write down all my notes. Once written, it's here. I use visual and auditory. So if I teach it to somebody, I listen to what I'm teaching and I can make out its effectiveness. So auditory learners would be able to learn better if given an opportunity to teach others. So you can give little projects to students and say, okay, you teach the other students these concepts if you're better in this. So auditory learners would do a better job in that. The kinesthetic learners are the ones who fidget the most in the classroom. They are the ones who will be shaking their legs, doodling with their pens. It doesn't mean that they're not learning. Sometimes the teacher feels that if somebody is shaking the leg, he is not interested. For them, movement is important. So, kinesthetic learners, movement, touch, feel becomes very important. So, they will highlight things that are they find are important to retain. They will use highlighters. They will use markers. They will write down the notes. Many of you will just listen. You have the notes in front of you right now. So you're listening. Others may be adding on to what's written in that notes. They are the movement kinesthetic ones. They retain better if they write it out. So movement then becomes important. So this is known as the VAC model, the visual, auditory and kinesthetic model. Now we'll go to MBTI. MBTI is basically, the full form is Myers-Briggs Type Indicator. This is an indicator of a set of learning styles. Actually, it's a personality tool. But there's a very strong relationship between personality and learning. So the whole tool is based on Jungian concept. Carl Jung was a successor of Sigmund Freud, if you've heard of Sigmund Freud, who and both Freud and Jung gave personality theories. And Jung gave a concept of extroversion and introversion. And based on that concept, Briggs developed a tool which is today very, very famously used as the MBTI tool, So if you were to go to a corporate sector and want to be recruited, they may give you an MBTI. It's as powerful as that. So MBTI is a very powerful tool to measure your personality. But here we'll try to understand it in the context of learning styles. There are four types of styles that we can derive from MBTI. Extroversion and introversion is the first one. Sensing versus intuition is the second one. Thinking versus feeling is the third one. Judging versus perceptive is the fourth one. Now, as the word extroversion means, it means that there is something external. Introversion, internal. If I were to link it up with personality, extroverts would be those who like to be in groups, they like to socialize, they like to talk to people and so on and so forth. Introverts are the ones who are more, in layman's words, reserved, like to be by themselves. Now how is it related to learning? In the learning process, introverts are the ones who would use reflective observation more. They are the ones who would like to think about what they are seeing on their own and develop the rules of the game, try to understand the underlying principle. Will there be a relationship between introversion and intuition? They would like to do individual projects. So if you give them group projects, they may not do very well on the group projects because they can't relate to people. But they're very efficient, they can do it individually. So they may not do well in a classroom if you give them group projects. They like to do individual projects. Extroverts, on the other hand, since their personality type is such that they like to socialize, they would do better if there is some kind of collaborative learning. If they are also told to teach others, you give them group projects. So in a classroom, you can give small groups. Break them into small groups and give them little projects to do, they learn better. So introversion and extroversion learning styles are based on the personality styles of extroversion and introversion. The second learning style based on MBTI is sensing versus intuition. The sensing learners are, as the word indicates, they use their senses more. So they will use visual, auditory, kinesthetic, they use the sense organs more, sensing, to learn better. So they are more organized, they learn stepwise in a linear fashion. So if you tell them, I am going to teach this in the class today, and I have broken it up into in this way, they'll absorb it well. In the ones who are intuitive learners, they learn better if you give them analogies. They learn by hunch. If you tell them principles more than the practice, they can, if you know, they know the abstract, they can develop the concepts better. So intuitive learners are based on this concept of sensing versus intuitive. So this is another kind of MBTI classification. If you see that these extroversion and introversion are not two extremes, they lie on a continuum. Similarly, sensing versus intuition are not extremes. None of the learning styles are extremes. They all lie on continuum. By that I mean to say that you can be located anywhere on that continuum. You could be near the extremes, you could be somewhere midway. You could use both. Thinking versus feeling. The thinking learners, they are more into inductive kind of learning. Logic. Why? The question why, they want the answer to that. So they try to get answers to the why. They think about it. So most of the things that they learn is based on some kind of logical analysis. The feeling learners are more into human values. So they are the ones who would look up to others to maybe solve the problem, and they will learn better from there. They may want that the teacher gives them group exercises because they feel they learn better when they are working in a group. The human element is there. So they don't reflect so much as the thinking ones. Judging versus perceptive. The judging learners are very interesting. If you say that you have to submit a project on this date, they will do it on time. I'm sure you have such students in the class. And you have another set of students, the moment the deadline comes, ma'am, can I give it tomorrow? Can you just, tomorrow is Saturday, Sunday, I'll give it to you on Monday. I'll slip it under your door. It's not that they're inefficient or they didn't want to do it. The perceptive learner, what they do is that they take up many things together. To solve the problem that you've given them or the project that you've given them, they want to do it in many ways. They're not sure which way they want to submit it in. So the moment the deadline approaches, they want an extension because they think that they need some more time. So, because they are more process oriented. The judging learners, they would have chosen a path and they say they are going to do a project like this, and so they meet the deadline. They plan it out properly. The perceptive learners will have, I'll read this, I'll read that, I'll read this. I'll read many things and get confused. I want more time. Can you give me an extension? So they are the ones who keep on asking for extensions. So that's the judgment versus perceptive. Now the difference between Kolb and MBTI. This is largely based on personality styles, where we're trying to apply the concept of personality in learning. And what is personality? Personality is the unique pattern of behaving. Everybody is a unique personality. No two people have an identical personality or even similar personalities. That's why we say that brother and sister are also not alike. So this is based on that concept of personality. Now I will come to the final one. But this is entirely based on research done on engineering students. So I kept it to the last one. So these authors, Felder and Silverman, have written a paper which is a very highly cited paper in Engineering Education Journal, where they talk of learning styles in engineering education. They begin by setting 5 questions for learning styles and 5 questions for teaching styles, and then they try to match the two. So I've written those questions here. The first question of how we can identify a learning style is, what type of information does the student predominantly perceive? Sensory versus intuitive. Second, which sensory channel is used effectively to perceive information? Visual versus auditory. Which organization of information is the student most comfortable with? Inductive versus deductive. How does a student process the information, actively versus reflectively? How does a student understand the information, sequentially or globally? So he says, first try to identify the learning style. I will explain all this in detail by trying to answer these questions. And these have some kind of teaching styles also synonymously. So ask this question. What type of information is emphasized by the teacher? What do you emphasize? Abstract or conceptual? What mode of presentation do you predominantly use? Visual or auditory? How do you organize the presentation? inductively or deductively? How much participation do you encourage? Do you allow students to participate in the class, active versus passive? And what is the perspective that you provide on the information that you give? Is it sequential or is it global? Putting these two together, this is what Felder found, that there is a relationship between the learning style and the teaching style. Sensory versus intuitive is related to, it's actually 2^5. You can have as many combinations of styles, matches of teaching and learning. Now, the question arises, can you really do it in a classroom? Because the student may be predominantly sensory, inductive, reflective, sequential. Another student may be intuitive, visual, inductive, active and sequential. A third student may be intuitive, auditory, inductive, reflective and global. What do you do? There can be all kinds of permutations and combinations. So let us try to understand what these actually mean. Going to the first one, sensory versus intuitive. Sensory learners will read facts or will look for facts. Those who use their sense organs more, they would search for facts in what's being taught in the classroom. They will look for data. They prefer experimentation. However, when it comes to solving problems, as a problem solver, they are like convergers that we saw earlier of Kolb. They will use standard tools to solve the problems. They will be quite patient with details inside the classroom. So if your lecture gets very lengthy and you keep on explaining in very simple language, they won't mind that. They'll assimilate all of that. They don't get bored with those details. They're good at memorizing the facts. So rote learning is also very high in them. They can be a little, you can say, careful and slow in the learning process. Why? Because till you are 100% sure of the facts, they are 100% sure that this is the mechanism of doing the thing, this is the correct way of doing it, they are not going to do it. So till they absorbed it, they will not to solve the problem. So they will be a little slow. Intuitives, on the other hand, they prefer principles, theories. So with the sensors, you could probably begin with applications. With the intuitors, because they prefer principles and theories, you can begin with principles and theories. They like innovation. They dislike repetition. They can get bored easily with details. So don't repeat over and over again the same point, thinking that you can, through this rehearsal process, make them memorize it, because they don't prefer memorization at all, like the sensory ones. They welcome complications. So if you teach complex things in the class, they enjoy that kind of teaching. They are good at grasping new concepts. They are very quick, but can get careless sometimes. They are very good with symbols. Research has, however, shown that when we are teaching, we are actually teaching the intuitors. That's what research tells. Why? Because we teach theory in the class. This is the biggest criticism of all engineering education. There's too much theory. We have very little of industrial experience. So there is ample evidence which suggests that in engineering education, we are actually catering more to the end users. We teach them more abstract things than concrete things. We don't encourage so much experimentation. We don't take them to the field. At least in Indian education system, I'm talking about. In the West, they are more in the field than in the classroom. So, we are catering more to intuitors than to sensors. That's the first kind of learning style that we're talking about. The second, I said, was visual and auditory. We've already done that to a certain extent, visual and auditory, where I said that in visual, they would like pictures, diagrams, films, demonstrations. The auditory would like to have verbal explanations. The third one, inductive versus deductive. In inductive, you will go logically. From particulars to generalizations. From the small picture to the large picture. There will be a linear progression. You will move from measurement of data to rules. So theories will come in later. Laws will come in later. First, the data and the measurement become important in inductive reasoning. Because it's based on facts. And you can use facts to logically argue out your argument. Deductive learners, they begin by understanding the basic principles first. And then working down to the application. So they like theory more before they want to actually practice. They deduce what will happen if we apply that theory. So deductive knowledge. So that's the difference between inductive and deductive learners. Active experimentation and reflective. Of course, active experimentation are the ones who are good at designing, carrying out experiments. The word active means that they actively participate in that learning process or that learning exercise. They can be good decision makers. They are good organizers. They organize their study material well. They work well in groups. Reflective learners, on the other hand, do not learn well if there is no opportunity to think, to reflect, to introspect, to be innovative, to have your own point of view. They don't want to listen to so-and-so said that and so-and-so said that. They'd like to think on their own. So that's reflective. So they learn better by themselves. They are good theoreticians. They can be good mathematical modelers. So the first active experimentation are the ones who can be good designers. So in industry you need designers. You also need modelers. So you may need modelers for, say, for example, for forecasting. People who forecast in business, you may need reflective thinkers or reflective learners. People who design, who can conceptualize, who have good conceptualization skills, you may need active experimentation learners. So there is a variation. The last one is the global versus sequential one. The sequential one are the people who would like to do things in small steps. So something like what the NCERT textbooks have broken down classroom teaching into unit 1, unit 2, unit 3, unit 4. And that's how we teach in the class also, that we move from simple to complex. And we'll say, when we come to the class, we'll say that this is what we are going to teach, and we'll teach you this first, and we'll teach you that for this, the second, and then we'll teach you this for the third, and so on and so forth. That's a sequential learning. In global, I can come to the class and say, I'm going to teach this particular concept, and I'll give a global picture first of the entire concept before I break it down into smaller units. So there can be sequential learners and there can be global learners. The sequential learners will always learn very systematically, point to point, because they are progressing in a linear fashion. The global ones are going to learn in fits and starts. Why? Because actually in a classroom, we are following more of a sequential order than the global order, from simple to complex. The global ones, you tell them the complex first, they'll break it down into simple. Suddenly, because it depends on intuition, how do they break it down? By hunch, make intuitive leaps. So for 10 days, they would just be sitting and doodling in the class and doing nothing. And suddenly, they'll come up with some unique solution to the problem. These will learn on the basis of the various rules that you have taught them. They'll solve the problem on the basis of those rules, sequentially. So that's what these various types of learning styles are, and the related to them are similar kinds of teaching styles. So then, last, how do we teach inside a classroom? First of it of all is, of course, that we have to motivate learning. And how do we motivate learning? We can motivate learning by using or catering to multiple learning styles. By that I mean to say that we should, now that we are aware of that there can be so many learning styles, there can be intuitive thinkers in the classroom, there can be deductive learning, there can be inductive learning, there can be visual, there can be auditory, there can be kinesthetic. So now your job is to see that you are able to motivate all these kinds of learners. Because if you use just one single mechanism of teaching, consistently you come to the class with your notes, you talk about something and you leave. You are not catering to. People are going to get bored, they will be demotivated. What's going to happen? There will be absenteeism, there will be late coming in the class. If all of that happens, as teachers also we get demotivated. If students are not motivated, teachers are also not motivated. So it has to be a reciprocal relationship. You have to motivate the learning process. So motivate them. So balance concrete information with abstract concepts. It all has to do with what we have done. Balance practical problem solving with fundamental understanding. Encourage students to use different styles. We will be having predominant styles, but try to encourage students to use multiple styles. Let them not be bogged down by a single style. Because there can be, or in fact, it's the truth that we always begin with theory in the class. Now learners who don't do well in theory, if they are going to get bored initially, with the theory if you simultaneously give some practical examples, you could gel well with the entire audience. The people who are interested in theory would be able to, the abstract thinkers and the concrete thinkers would be able to do well. So try to encourage use of different styles. Don't keep on lecturing inside if it's a 1 hour class. Give breaks. By breaks I mean maybe after some time ask a question. Give them a surprise problem. Ask them to give a solution in 5 minutes. Take a break. Let them think. Don't just come and continuously lecture for an hour. It gets boring. So give them little breaks in between. So after having taught for 15 minutes, maybe you can give them a question on what you taught in the last 15. Or ask them something. If you taught a theory, ask them to give the application. Encourage class activities like group projects, etc. You can encourage them. Don't give them very fixed kinds of problems. Textbook kind of problems. Give them problems when they can use reflection. So open-ended problems and exercises. Now, you may tell me that we are in an educational pattern where it cannot permit, because ultimately they have to appear in an examination. That's the unfortunate part, that we teach students to appear for the exam. We don't teach to educate them. We need to educate them. So forget the examination. Educate them. That is our job. They will appear in the examination if they are educated. Fine. But give them an opportunity to think. So give open-ended problems. Encourage group work. Encourage creativity. And guide your students. Make students understand what the predominant styles are and how they can use multiple styles. It's important that they use multiple styles. So, while basically sum up by saying that all styles are equally effective, you cannot say that auditory is more effective than visual, or abstract is more effective than concrete. All styles are effective. There's nothing good or bad of these styles, so no value judgment. And what is important is that you have to provide an adaptable learning environment. And you can do that by using all these multiple approaches to your teaching. Don't use a singular approach and let students learn to adapt to these multiple ways of learning. Recognize your own style, which we try to do, so that you don't avoid that bias while you're teaching. If you yourself like theory, you'll teach only theory inside the classroom. That bias should not be there. And use different methods of teaching. You must remember that these learning styles are not very stable. They can change with time. People's styles do change with time. Then they can vary with the learning task. So you can learn a particular subject using visual cues more. You can learn either using auditory or kinesthetic more. So it's not true that every discipline, every subject, every course that they do, they're going to use the same learning style. The need may be different to understand that particular subject. Should the learning and instructional style match? Not necessarily. A mismatch can occur, and there's nothing wrong in it occurring. It's bound to happen. But the mismatch should not be perennial. Because the teacher may have a predominant style of teaching and the student may have a predominant style of learning, and there can be a mismatch. What the teacher really needs to recognize now is that he has to use all the styles to reduce that mismatch. Mismatch is going to happen because there are going to be so many styles inside the classroom. Should one focus on the individual or should one focus on the group? Sometimes it may be necessary to focus on the individual, sometimes it may be necessary to focus on the group, again depending on what kind of activity you are doing in the classroom. Whether it's an individual examination, you may have to focus on the individual and how well he has done in the exam and whether he has understood and whether you need to coach an individual more than the others. If it's a group activity, then obviously you are looking at the group. So these are some of the things, so I'll stop at that. And I think his references are there.
Discuss more on the issue of working in groups and working as individuals. I've seen that some students perform really very well when they're working as individuals because they feel, you know, discussion with their colleagues has interference. But then this is not desirable when they're in the work environments. So how do you make really them to understand that working in groups is not something as interference to your own thinking, your own performance?
As far as research also is concerned, there are two points of view that it has still not been resolved. Whether people are good at working as individuals or whether people are good as when they work in groups. There are many reasons for it. When you're working as an individual, you have control over the process. You have control over yourself. When you're working in a group, there's a diffusion of responsibility. By diffusion of responsibility, you can pass the buck easily. So the interest of the decision gets lost. The rewards are shared in a group. Individual, the rewards, no. Learning is also based on rewards. There is a second theory, I only spoke to you of learning in classical conditioning. There is another theory which is operant conditioning. which says that learning is based on the amount of reinforcement, that is the reward that you get from learning. And the entire principle of incentives in the workplace, that is your compensation package, your fringe benefits, your perks, will depend on your performance, how well you do. So you will learn and you will adapt to changes and perform well if your rewards are individual based. These days there is this concept of a group incentive plan. That is, the whole team, if it performs, will get equitable rewards. So we are getting into another realm entirely, concepts of equity theory. You know, all those things are related to reinforcement, that is the reward and the incentive that you get. So there are going to be individual variations on that. And it would, I think it would be unreasonable to pass any judgment that individuals perform better or groups perform better. There are going to be variations in the workplace also. So you cannot convince an individual who likes to work individually but is placed in a group in the workplace will leave it, will be dissatisfied, or will perform poorly. Okay, I think I'll have to stop now. Thank you very much.